Hi there, and Merry Christmas 2007. Happy New Year 2008. I was watching videos this morning on educational reform, and I saw this video about Asperger's syndrome. I've taught school for many, many years in San Francisco, and I taught inclusion along with gifted, regular classes, kindergarten all the way up through eighth grade. I actually dealt with children with Asperger's syndrome, and I discovered something absolutely amazing. When you take the labels off the child and you give the child freedom to explore and define what they really want to learn on their own terms, by their own timetable. And according to their passions, they practically wake up and forget they've ever been diagnosed with anything called Asperger's syndrome. In fact, I had a young girl who was brought into my class, my sixth grade class, by her mom, terrified that she wouldn't be able to last a week in my class because she would become frustrated with the harsh treatment of having to sit in her seat all day and be treated like some kind of slave, which is what the public school system does so well. I talk about that clearly in Uncle Tom's Classroom, my book that I'm going to talk about in a minute. Anyway, I immediately liked the young lady, and I told her at the very beginning, the very first week of school, I said, I don't believe in any of the labels, and I'm going to give you a new kind of freedom to make your space in the classroom and to find your way. And if you feel like you're getting upset and you want to lash out and hit somebody, come and tell me, and we'll let you run around the school, or we'll let you do something to get to process that energy in a way that won't get you into trouble and get you sent to another class. You know what? This young lady responded totally, she got it. I mean, she totally got it. She desperately wanted to be in my class. And so she began to self, what I call, learn self-government. She began by governing and watching her verbal responses. She began to watch how she responded physically with her arms and legs, and she became conscious. And she woke up, and she became one of my great leading students. And her progress that year was so amazing. It was one of the reasons why I decided to try to capture and write about what I did in my classroom. I do write about it in Uncle Tom's Classroom, how one public school teacher awakened his students to the cosmic super self within. And I begin now reading an introduction called The Liberation of a Generation. I start with a quote by Harriet Beecher Stowe, in which she says, "This little volume is about the liberation of a race with a tender character, unlike the hard and dominant race, a race hitherto ignored by society." Now, Harriet was, of course, talking about African Americans, but when I read this quote, I immediately thought of my beautiful students, the thousands and thousands of students that I've taught over the years that were treated as if they were slaves to a system that is basically out of control and doesn't know what it's doing. I sat in the class one day and wrote this poem, "A Race Called Every Child. I am the voice of every child, crying out to the giants of the world. Cut not my wings, blind not my ears, I mean, blind not my eyes, deafen not my ears, and fill not my mind with your age-old fears. Just teach me, please, the truth of who I am. Let me discover where I come from. Tell me why I'm here, and teach me that no matter what I dream, I always, always can. Please unchain me from your past. Don't force me to forget my source. For I have a divine right to learn the truth of who I really, really, really am." So now I'd like to read to you a short segment from the beginning of my book, in which I describe that wonderful moment between classes when the children would come in and out during between periods, and I would get a chance to shake their hand. I write, "One of my favorite times during a typical day teaching middle school was when I stood at the door of my classroom and greeted each of my 130 students as they changed classes. I enjoyed that brief moment when I shook hands with them, connecting in a personal way. This was one of the few opportunities during my hectic daily schedule when I had a moment to speak directly to each and every one of my students." I say my students on purpose because I homework that week, which was my last week teaching in the San Francisco public school system, was one of my most cutting-edge assignments ever, a task that required my students to take possible realities. So I asked my students that last week in the system to stretch their minds and imagine an alternative probable American history in which the Europeans did not destroy the Native American cultures and did not enslave the Africans. I asked my students to open their minds and visualize another American virtual history in which the Europeans, the Indian tribes, the Africans, and all the other immigrant groups that traveled to the New World in search of freedom had chosen to work together in unison to create a nation of true equality and justice for all. It was during passing time that I had a chance to find out if any of my children were late finishing their assignment or needed an extension. "Hi there, Helen. Did you turn in your homework?" I asked Helen as she tried to sneak out of the room after fifth period class. "I didn't see your work here in my stack of papers." Helen was one of my best eighth grade students at AP Giannini Middle School in San Francisco, California. She was a sweet Chinese American teenager, very studious, quiet, supremely intense, intelligent, and usually very conscientious about completing her social studies assignments on time. But she often slumped when she walked and usually looked a bit sad. I didn't really like pressuring her about her work, but I was curious as to why she hadn't completed her recent assignment, which was so very unusual for her. "I didn't have time to do it, Mr. Berg," she said, tears welling up in her eyes. "I'm really, really sorry." She began to cry softly. "Would you like to talk about it after school?" I asked, immediately feeling guilty that I caused her unnecessary misery. "Remember, Helen, I'm here for you. Don't worry. I'm on your side." "Yes," she answered, "I know. I would like to talk to you privately. I'll be back at 3:30 if that's okay with you." She did return that afternoon, which gave me an opportunity to find out what was really bothering her. She walked in the room, threw her heavy backpack on the floor, sighed, and squeezed into a chair far too small for her 5-foot frame. "I hate my life," she began. "I hate myself. My parents don't care about me. They don't understand me. They're always pressuring me to work, 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 work. They make me go to Chinese school, take piano lessons, do the chores around the house, and even compete in track. I hate track. I never have any time just for myself. I don't even have time to think anymore." She began to cry softly. "Mr. Berg, I feel so trapped, really, really trapped. There's no way that I could get myself to think about your really far out idea about an alternative American history." Tears began to pour down her bright pink cheeks. "I'm sorry, Helen, if I added to your problems.